I wondered how Teddy could care so much for his dad who practically killed him, and I couldn't give a shit about my own dad who hadn't laid a hand on me since I was three. And that was for eating bleach under the sink.
You raped my old man.
Why do you care what a fat old pile of shit like him says about your dad? He still stormed the beach at Normandy, right?
Yeah, forget it.
You think that pile of shit was at Normandy?
See, this is an interesting example of how these kids interacted with each other and how they picked up the cues. This is one shot, basically. It's a Steadicam shot, and you can see how the timing works. And they all, it's almost like a play, and they had to learn how to do this. It wasn't done in little bits and pieces. A lot of times with young actors, you have to do that in order to get them to get the performance. But we worked together so much beforehand, like I say, 2 weeks of rehearsal beforehand, that we, and you see just the perfect timing where Jerry O'Connell comes in with the singing, and you watch how they stare him, and he backs off, and all of that. And this was all done in one shot here. And so you can, the timing was great, and they really learned how to work with each other.
Yeah, it's okay. I'm not sure it should be a good time. You say
this is the first time we have a cutaway.
No.
But up till that point, it was one shot.
I want to see a dead kid. Maybe it shouldn't be a party. Yeah. Like if he's really bad, like all cut up in blood and shit all over him, I might have nightmares.
Come on, girl.
You know, like all guts and eyeballs over to jump and grab.
Shut up,
come on,
girl.
God damn it! I can't help it. Sorry.
It was only a quarter to three, but it felt much later. It was too hot and too much had happened. We weren't even close to the Royal River yet. We were going to have to get moving if we were going to make some real miles before dark.
I wonder who.
And here's Book of Love by the Monotones. And my little boys, who I have two little boys, 8 and 6, they always ask me, how do they do this scene with the guy doing the tattoo? They had a little bulb underneath this where he's holding his hand and he squirts the blood out. So it looks like he's digging into his arm, but he's actually squirting blood onto his arm.
Catholic, man. They're all like that. You want to get laid, you got to get yourself a Protestant. Jews could.
A KLAM news break. We interrupt to bring you an update on the search for the missing...
In this backyard, we actually found this place up in Oregon, and it was pretty much the way you see it, except it was about three times as much junk in the backyard. We actually had to clean it up to make it look like this, because nobody would believe there was that many busted cars in the backyard.
You're making me fuck up the snake part.
I'll tell you how they're going to find him. 10 years from now, some hunter's going to go in the woods to take a leak, wind up pissing on his bones.
I'll bet you $1,000 he'd find him before that.
Bet you $2,000 he don't.
Well, asshole.
Hey, what's the big deal? Who cares?
Would you two just shut the fuck up? If either one of you assholes had $2,000, I'd kill you both.
Hey, we're back here with the boss man, Bob Cormier. From the racks and stacks, it's the best on wax. It's the Cornettes with Lollipop.
And this dance that they used to do, this little move, where moves you used to see these 50s groups have all the time, and this stuff we used to do all the time with Lollipop. We used to sing and do the popping sound with our mouths.
Hey, I got some Winstons. Hock them off my old man's dresser. One piece for after supper. Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
It's when a cigarette tastes best, after supper.
Right.
Do you think I'm weird?
Definitely.
No, man, seriously. Am I weird?
See, this is another example of how they're playing these scenes out without a lot of cuts, and it takes a lot of work with young actors to get them to listen to each other and to come in with the right timing. Yeah. But these kids were unbelievably great.
You know what that means. The next unit will be split up. What are you talking about? Why would that happen? It's not going to be like grammar school, that's why. If you're taking your college courses and meet Teddy and Vern while we'll be in the shop courses with the rest of the retards making ashtrays and birdhouses.
And you can see River Phoenix has, even at this very young age, had an amazing maturity about him. He had a lot of depth and a lot of wisdom. It's so sad what happened to him, because he was... A really enlightened soul in some ways, and in other ways he was just a kid who was confused. So it was a very, very sad thing that happened to him.
I saw the other day you was carrying 5 elephants in one hand.
Boy, you don't know nothing. Mighty Mouse is a cartoon. Superman is a real guy. No way a cartoon could beat up a real guy.
Yeah.
This is arguments that we actually used to have. Who was stronger, Mighty Mouse or Superman? And we actually took all these conversations that we had and we put them right in the film. And so we have these two guys talking about very deep, important things, and the guys in the front talking about these very frivolous things. And the counterpoint, I think, is terrific.
I don't know how your dad feels about you. He doesn't give a shit about you. Danny was the one he cared about. Don't try to tell me different.
You're just a kid, Gordy.
Oh, gee, thanks, Dad. Wish the hell I was your dad. You wouldn't be going around talking about taking these stupid shop courses if I was. It's like God gave you something, man. All those stories that you can make up. And he said, this is what we got for you, kid. Try not to lose it. But kids lose everything unless there's someone there to look out for them. And if your parents are too fucked up to do it, then maybe I should.
Come on, you guys, let's get moving.
Yeah, by the time we get there, the kid won't even be dead anymore.
And here comes Buddy Holly with Every Day. It's one of my favorite songs.
Than a roller coaster, love like yours will surely come my way. Hey, 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 every day it's getting faster.
Here's the famous trestle scene. We shot this in Redding, California. And this trestle actually exists, and it's about 100 feet above the water. And it was very scary shooting up in this, up on this trestle.
Any of you guys know when the next train is due?
We could go down to the Route 136 bridge.
What are you, crazy? That's 5 miles down the river. You walk 5 miles down the river, you gotta walk 5 miles back. That could take till dark. We go across here, we can get to the same place in 10 minutes.
Yeah, but if a train comes, there's nowhere to go.
No, there isn't. Just jump.
Teddy, it's 100 feet.
Yeah, Teddy.
Look, you guys can go around if you want to. I'm crossing here. And while you guys are dragging your candy asses halfway across the state and back, I'll be waiting for you on the other side, relaxing with my thoughts.
You use your left hand or your right hand for that?
You wish.
That was one of my favorite exchanges. Actually, I did quite a bit of writing on the film as well, and my friend Andy Scheinman also did a lot of writing, and his wit and intelligence and humor is evidenced in the screenplay as well as Brian Bruce's. This sequence that you're about to see was a combination of using doubles, using the kids themselves. We did all kinds of long lenses, and we also used some process shots that we shot indoors to make it look like the train was bearing down on them. But it was one of the few sequences that in my history of my film career that I actually storyboarded and worked out ahead of time, because it was just too complicated to do just on the fly, which is the way I do most of my shot making. I just try to put a shot list together the day I'm shooting. But in the case of this sequence, we really did plan it out quite thoroughly to make sure we had every shot planned. This was done with a helicopter, and it's a beautiful place in Redding, California. These shots we did on a mock-up trestle that we put to the side over actual dry land. So we did some of those shots as well.
Train! Oh, shit. Move it, man. Go on, move it. Get up first.
This was shot, like I say, as a mock-up. This was shot inside a studio. It's a process shot. And there's a rear projection there.
Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God.
Again, this is another in-studio shot. This was shot with doubles. Not with the real actors, but with doubles. Again, there's another shot with doubles. There's doubles again. This is shot with a very, very long 600-millimeter lens, and it looks like the train is right on top of them, but in fact, the train was not even entering the trestle, and the boys were on the other side of the trestle. That was also shot inside of a studio. But those shots where the train looks like it's right on top of them, the train was hundreds of yards away from them.
Hey, at least now we know when the next train was due. Man, that was the old-time train dodge. Too cool. Vern, you were so scared you looked like that fat guy Abbott Costello when he saw the mummy.
I wasn't that scared. No, really, I wasn't. Sincerely.
Okay, then you won't mind if we check the seat of your jockeys for Hershey Sports, will you?
Oh, screw.
Hey, Vern, you better turn yours over.
This is the way I like to do it.
Fine.
Aw, man! Come on, no, man, you got any more, Gordy?
Sorry, Vern.
It's not funny. What am I supposed to eat?
Why'd you cook your neck? Be a small meal.
Uh-huh. Screw you guys, I got it.
This whole sequence we shot indoors because we're using miners. You can't really shoot very late at night, and we thought it would be much more production smart for us to shoot indoors.
What? What did I say?
This next sequence coming up, where they talk about the what's goofy and the difference between goofy and of course we're going to see. Wait a minute, I think we're going to see the Lard S. Hogan story. Yeah, that's what we're going to see first.
Why don't you tell us one about Sergeant Steele and his babbling leathernecks?
Well, the one I've been thinking about is kind of different. It's about this pie eating contest. And the main guy that's
here we go. This is the pie eating contest. This scene we shot, and it went over huge with an audience. And even to this day, I wrestle with the fact that I don't know if it was the best idea that we could have come up with for Gordy to tell them a story. It's a perfect 12-year-old story, you know, where barfing is at the center of it. But I always thought that Gordy, who ultimately would turn into a great writer someday, might tell a little bit more, I don't know, I guess even sophisticated story for a 12-year-old. But we settled on this story. This was the story that was in the book, and we shot it, and the audience loved it. And so I guess I basically felt we had to go along with it.
At school, they put this sticker on his back that says wide load, and they rank him out and beat him up whenever they get a chance. But one day he gets an idea. The greatest revenge idea a kid ever had.
Is this thing on? Can you hear me? Now, the next contestant in the great Tri-County Pie Eat, Principal John Wigan.
We had a heck of a time coming up with just the right consistency for the barf. It ultimately became a blend of a large curd cottage cheese and blueberry pie filling. But we tried all kinds of different mixtures, and that was what we eventually came up with. And rigging the people to barf on everybody was also an interesting premise. This is one of the more interesting days of the shoot.
Fight, but one we expect great things from in the future, young Master David Hogan.